So I decided to do this competition just to learn more about data science. And the music recommendation system is actually a nice one because there's a lot of data in it. And it's a kind of a challenging problem. So, and it's an interesting problem too to solve. So I'll begin by, actually I did my master's in Saskatchewan. So computer science, then at the same time I worked for some research labs, doing some projects for industries and also, yeah, some of them are classified too. So right now I'm working for one startup called Apivio. So we do more of smart meters, network system, network protocol stuff. So I don't do any data science at work. So this competition is a very nice one in the regards like they try to prevent fitting to the leaderboard where people submit repeatedly and then end up overfitting to the board. So there's like 5 submissions per day. And then we go through some visualization of the data and then what evaluation methods we can use. And then I'll just do a little bit of tutorial on some like the traditional recommender system, what it stands for, before describing what this competition is all about in terms of how it's evaluated. And so this data is more of like listening habit of a user, like you have a kind of a mobile phone, because they have a mobile app, this company that launched this competition. So you have like a list of songs you've listened to over time. So and this data has no timestamp in it, but it's chronologically ordered. So it's like, there's an implicit time in it. Because like you listen to one song before listening to the next. So there's an order in how you listen to these songs. But there's no timestamp. So the idea is like, they believe if they give you the timestamps, you can actually end up like data leaks. That's what they think. So they wrote about it. And pretty much this data set is balanced. So in terms of the classification they're trying to solve. So now.
Sorry, just a question about the timestamp, because there is this notion of a 1 month period, right?
Yeah.
So how do you know how long 1 month is if you don't have timestamps?
Yeah, that's why I had to discuss about the boundary problem.
Okay.
So I had a lot of issues with that, and that actually wasted a lot of my time too. So, and I would get to that part. So this, because since you don't know how long the month is, so you just have to infer it from the data. So it's a kind of unobserved, so you need a model that can actually capture those time properties for you and figure out the months. So even though you don't have it implicitly. Like for instance, the third place solution did a very clever thing, and I would also show its code. So it took me a while to understand what it did, but it's actually the first time I've seen someone trying to put a kind of notion of time into a data without time. And I've not seen any of those before in the past. So that's the good thing with Kaggle is like when you see some kernels, people actually use the concept you've read in a textbook in a way you've not seen before. And you'll be amazed, like, how did this guy think about this? So I saw many of those kind of solutions. And so the kernels are a very important part of Kaggle competition. So pay attention to them. So it's like, this data set actually, they have a so the point is, if you listen to a song in the recent past, predictive that song will be replayed again like within a month. So and it's just like if it's replayed, it's one. If it's not replayed, it's zero. So it's more like the classification problem. And
okay. Can you describe what you mean by balanced data sets in this
okay.
situation?
A balanced data set is a set with like in this context. When you visualize data, it's like there's almost equal proportions of the ones that did not no one listened to and what they listened to. So it's like, I mean, when you consider the entire data set, the training set itself, and check the labels on them. So it's like the distribution is pretty much even. It's like they're almost equal proportions. So and they also tried to. Like this competition, I think it's really worked out for the people who sponsored it. Because one, even the metric actually, they try to, even if, because they can use this for other kind of projects, even if it's on balanced data set, because the metric you're optimizing is AUC. But we'll get to that too. So I think this was well designed, and I think they had the value for the money for the from this competition. So they it was really a good competition for the sponsors.
Did they say what their how good their current method is?
No, they
didn't.
They didn't say it.
They usually don't.
Yeah, so some information is like there's a total $5,000 to make from this competition. So the first place gets $3,000, second place $2,000, and the third place $1,000. And this qualifies you for a conference. And you can actually, if you finish top 10 or so, you can actually write your the summary of what you've done in a kind of a paper format, ACM style, and then have a paper published. So it's like multiple, there is like research-based competition somehow. And then this company also had a sister competition at the same time. So this is more like churn prediction. So they were like trying to predict when a user stops subscribing to their service. So like you have a user, how predicts how likely that user is to stop subscribing to your service. So and they are both related to this recommender system. So it's like, I believe they are using these competitions to solve all the problems they have at work. So which is very good. So now you can actually solve this, because I was trying to solve this problem as a classification problem at some point. And then I also tried some sequence prediction. So sequence prediction is like, you try to predict a number of data points that has an order between them. So it's like, you want to predict, okay, what's the path from this place to that place? So you don't just say, okay, you've gone there, but you want to see, okay, which road you took to get there. So it's like kind of a chain of music at that point. So because if you have your test data, you can actually predict stuff like that. So because if you know what somebody has been listening for a while, you can actually project from that point to what you could listen to in the future. So if you have the history from the present, you could predict the future. So yeah, but I think most people are solving it as a classification problem at some point. So, but I would explain how all the things I tried to that didn't work out. So they had a number of data sets. So these are the most important ones, just some kind of ID number, system tabs. This is like the, okay, it's like if you're on your app, there are different tabs you can be on. So they actually looking based on which tabs you were on, which songs did you listen to? Is that a categorization from the app, their music app in their system? So they actually captured those. So they wanted to see how those also affect the stuff. So then the song too, they captured things about the song itself. So things like who composed it, the lyrics, what language is it in, and what's the song length. So because those can be actually very informative too. It's like how long someone listens to a song. Maybe some people may prefer longer songs to a shorter song. I think there's some kind of information in there too. Then,
are you going to tell us some of the numbers, like how many songs, how many members?
Yeah, that's
coming up. Okay.
Yeah, the visualization part. So, yeah, they also had some data about the members themselves, those who are actually using this app. So, the date of birth, the gender, when they were registered. And some of those data is noisy. They are noisy, like the date of birth. So most people may not put their real date of birth. It's a bit noisy. So there's some extra information. And then this IRCC stuff is like kind of unique identification for music. It's like international kind of coding stuff. So it doesn't make much sense. So, but it's there. So it's like.
I read a little bit about this. So you were allowed to use as much public information as you wanted. Which is a little unusual. They don't often let you do that. So the ISRC is like an index into this database of stuff. But they warn you right in the competition that that's not a very reliable source. But it's better than nothing, I guess. But you're allowed to use anything you can get your hands on.
Yeah. So this is the distribution of, they have something called a source type, like a classification based on which part of the app you get things. So it's like I don't know what distribution I call this, but you can just see how frequent those, like the online playing list is about 200,000. So that we have more than 3 million data sets in this competition. So it's a lot of data to play around. So this is actually classifying them in terms of how to see, like, just to have a notion of how balanced things are. So it's like from the data set they offered. So the number of ones that were listened to, and that you were like, for instance, if you look at this local library source type, you can actually see like the ones that we attacked zero among all the number of training sets. It's pretty much even. So that's why I was saying it's balanced in most of the articles.
So, one means that the person will listen to the song again in the next month, and zero means that they will not listen to the song again.
Yeah. And a lot of columns have variables too.
So that's over all users though, isn't it?
All the 27, over all the 27.
Right. So it means some user listened to the song more than once.
So this is a global
view. The same user, I think.
Oh, it's all the single user?
Well,
no, it's not single user. Okay, it's actually, they are taking a global view of everything. So they're not actually focusing on a particular user.
But for it to count as one, it has to be the same user listening within a month.
Right.
Yes.
It's not any user.
But there are many users. But there are many users, right? So at least one user listened to this.
It's like it counts.
Right?
It's just
so
a count.
For a given user, no one user is listening to all the millions of songs.
That's
more than once.
Right.
But you're predicting for one user. So like it makes sense here for radio, right? Like you probably don't have that song, so it's probably not that easy for you to listen to any random song that you listen on the radio. So it kind of makes sense to me that it would be zero, or there would be more zeros than there would be ones, as opposed to local library where you actually have gone through the effort to get that song on your local computer or something. So you're probably going to listen to those ones more.
Question: how can you tell whether the same user listening to the song, or they're all new users, new listeners?
Yeah, actually, it's just aggregation, and it's part of the data processing. You can just group things by user ID.
Oh, I see. So no repeat users, all in separate users, right? Okay.
Yeah, so it's just counting it, so it's a count.
Okay, thanks.
So just to have an idea of how the data will be distributed, is it balanced or not? So, for instance, if you have a data set where everyone has listened at least once and it's one or two, so it's like it's hard to actually learn anything from the data then, because you only have only positive samples. So it's much better if you have both positive and negative samples, so your model can at least learn some of the underlying representation that may actually capture like what the moment is. So it's like your model has to be time sensitive. So that's one of the challenges of these computations too. So
suppose I listen to a song, and then a month and a half later I listen to that song again. That's a zero?
Yeah, it's a zero.
And if I listen to it a week later after that, now it suddenly becomes a one?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's very interesting.
So it's time sensitive.
Oh,
Do you have to listen to the whole song or only part of it?
They actually write how long that song lasts. So they don't tell us. I think if you look at the user part, there's no part of how the duration at the current time. It's actually the duration of the song in its whole. So the assumption is that the user listens to all the song, which may not actually hold in those situations. Yeah, but you need to make some assumptions, because you already have a lot of constraints. Like for instance, we don't know what the month is, because you don't have what the time is too. So if you put so many constraints, the problem may become intractable. So I think maybe that's why they did that way too.
Do you know what time period this data came from?
Oh, they actually presented this amount, I can't remember of it.
But do you know like the length of that time period? Was this like 12 months or like 6 months or 1 month?
I can actually check it up.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but it's actually, they actually split it apart. So the training set was before the test set.
Mm.
So it's like, it's a time series too, as they took it. So they actually took care not to mix leak information into the training set. So there are some screen names based on how the apps work. So so I didn't have time to look at every screen names, like to see time constraints too. You just wanna Yeah, so so this is just like to show some of the distributions of how everything operates. Yeah, this is just screen names to like to show the how balanced the data set is. There's a source tab. So these are those all variables they capture too. So this is all about showing, okay, this is the proportion of the users, the gender of the users, male to female. So, and this is okay, it's pretty much even those who are males have similar, yeah, the languages too. I think 38, somewhere 30 or 52 is English. One of them is English, but it's Korean. So this is a Korean competition. So these are like the cities where people were, and those numbers represent some cities itself where those people are. So they were expecting that maybe you can get some information from the cities too.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to provide some cities. So then I go to the correlation metric. So the correlation metric used in this competition is the AUC. So it's the area under curve. So it's like you have the two positive rates and the false positive rate. So it's like out of the tier two sets, for instance, which of them do you predict to be true? So then out of the false ones, which do you predict to be false in it? What's the proportion of the truth of the positive ones in the total positive that I said based on your model? And then what's the proportion of negative sets based on what your model outputted compared to the entire population of the negative sets? So then this is just there's a close relationship between these and the normal precision recall we have. So this is just to show some example of calculating some of those. So then I put up this stuff. For instance, if you already have a way of calculating your two positive rates, it's pretty easy. If you have a confusion matrix, you just have some thresholds. Do you know what a confusion matrix is? But a confusion matrix is actually a matrix where after you classify your data, so you have what the two labels are versus what the predicted labels are. So it's like you have a kind of count of out of the, it's like your predicted versus the two. So out of the predicted ones, so how many of the real items did you predict right, and how many did you predict wrong in it? So it's like if you have on your y-axis, for instance, on the x-axis, for instance, you have this as your two classes, and you have on this side your predicted classes. So after you want to predict, which of the two classes did you make a mistake on? And then you can actually use that confusion matrix to calculate your true positive rate. When you vary the thresholds, if you make a classification, for instance, you may predict a score. Then you want to map this to 0 or 1. So you may want to do some thresholds in, like, if you're greater than a particular value, like, any value, maybe 0.5 as much as you could do. See, it's 1, if it's less than that, it's 0. But if you're building this kind of graph stuff, you start from, if your threshold is 0, what's your true positive rate and what's your false positive rate? If it's 0.2, what's it? So you can actually plot a graph by varying your thresholds. So as your thresholds vary, you can actually end up plotting this graph. So, there's actually a relationship between those two. Like, I was only reading a paper too that was saying actually that if you optimize your F score, for instance, you're actually optimizing your AUC indirectly. So, as a proxy. But it's not the other way around, it's a one way relationship. So, they provided some proofs about that too. So, I was actually analyzing this. Okay, is AUC by a particular user versus the entire group? So which is better? Well, after listening for a while, I realized actually the competition firm, the organization that sponsored the competition, and they took a better decision by going for the entire group. Because in that case, they can actually solve things like cold start problems. Because if you have a user who is registering, so it's better to have some existing data rather than having empty data when you video. So it's like, so if you optimize for the entire group at once as a score rather than for each user, it's a better metric for you. So, and the competition organizers also thought of that, from what I saw. So, yeah, someone was the first place solution guy was actually saying, recommending that, oh, that the metric wasn't good, and he preferred to get the metric of all the users, the AUC of all the users, and take an average of them. So, but I disagree with him in that regard, because then you fall victim to the code stack problem. So, yeah, and there are many other, like, when people like this kind of AUC, it's better for when you have an unbalanced data set, where you like, you have some maybe more positive samples than negative samples. Because most times if you try an accuracy and do stuff, your accuracy will be very high, which doesn't mean much. So for instance, if you have so many positive cases and very less negative cases, it's already very high, the positive case. So if you keep predicting positives, whatever input you get, you still be right for most of the proportions of your positive cases you have. So, and which is not actually what you may want in the model. You may want a model that actually, that can still capture those minimal cases, those less cases, and also the higher cases occurrence too. So, and AUC also is better because then it's bounded in an interval between 0 and 1. So if you're close to 0, that means you're not doing anything. So if you're close to 0.5, that probably you have just a triangle. So for instance, it's just this triangle. So that's your baseline. So you're almost like random. So it's like that should be the output of making a random guess. So but you should aim to actually get the area under this curve to be like 1. So this is like a unit space of the curve. So it's like, so that's what you should aim for. So yeah. So your model, so the best model in this competition actually had like 0.754, so which is really good for an AUC score. Yeah. Because I'll discuss that later. So now in recommender systems, there are two types of recommender systems basically. You have this collaborative type and the content based type. Collaborative type is just like spreading the message around your friends. So if you like something, your friend who is of the same age and maybe same university with you would like those. So the point is you're trying to use those common properties among the people to recommend similar items to them. So these are things common between those group of people, which they may not really know even sometimes. So you're exploiting some latent information from just the relationship between the people. Using it. Then like content based is like when you have an item, so you can actually have a kind of a representation of that item in a kind of a vector space, and then you may most likely recommend a similar item that has some kind of matching with the vector of that item you have. So it's like someone who buys a car may most likely buy maybe a tire or something. So it's them, it kind of, because those are kind of similar items. So depending on how your space is. So this is just like a kind of a brief description of how the mathematical formulation of recommender system is in general. So there can be many variations of these problems. So the onus for you is to identify it when you see it, because it may actually be paraphrased in a different way. For instance, our problem was actually looking more like a sequence problem. And it's not so different from a normal recommender system where you just recommend items to people. Just imagine the user is in one spot, and you're I've listened to this music from the past until this current music now. So the goal for me is which ones will I listen to in the future? So if you think it that way, actually, you're actually trying to predict which amount of songs to recommend to the same user. So it's like a recommender system that you already have. So but if you think it's in a very narrow case, you'll be thinking, oh, this is a different problem, but it's actually the same thing. So then it's like you have a set of users and a set of items. I should be looking at this. Yeah. So you have a set of users and a set of items, and then usually in a normal recommender system, you have like users who rate some items. So like someone gives a score on a particular item. So and maybe 0 to 5 as most cases are. And then you have all the items that have been rated by a user. That's like my I subscript you. So your goal is to find the kind of a function that takes, that identifies, that maps the relationship between the user and the items to the ratings. So you can predict future ratings. So your goal is to identify what F is. So whatever we're doing in this competition is just to identify an F. So but usually do those kind of those rating matrix, for instance, it's usually very sparse. Because a lot of people may not rate some items. They only rate items when they're like very angry or when they're very happy. So but in our competition we have some stuff there that there's a hidden signal because it's an implicit signal, so it's not like explicit, they don't have to rate. But you can actually see listening, the time, the duration listened to, or how many times listened to as a signal of how the, because a person who likes a song may listen to it multiple times or replay it for a longer time too. So you see now we have the same kind of problem formulation. So then the most common forms you're used to is like the best item recommendations and the top, maybe, okay, the top five, what's the most likely 5 objects you're about to buy next. So this kind of stuff. So this is just maximizing this function where you like taking a set difference. What I mean by set difference is like you don't want to recommend the same item to the same user after he has bought it already. In a normal case, it's like it doesn't make sense. I just bought a car and you're recommending a car to me again. So I won't likely buy it. So in this case, you're trying to eliminate what the user has already rated in the past. And then see which maximizes your function or minimizes your function based on your problem formulation.
So you can tell that to Google because it's always recommending things to me that I just bought. But I have a question. So I just want to make sure I understand. It's not obvious that this prediction problem is a recommendation problem.
It's not obvious, but if you think it mathematically to some extent, you may generalize to it or like
okay,
reduction.
But the idea is, I mean, we're given a test time, the predictions we have to make, we're given a song, we're given a user, and we're supposed to predict where that user is going to listen to that song more than once or again. And I guess if we would recommend that song to that person, the assumption is they would listen to it again. So it's in that sense. Okay. So did everyone use this sort of recommender approach, or did people tackle more directly a prediction?
Yeah, I think many people use this kind of factorization machine kind of approach too, to augment with some embeddings, and then some a lot of feature engineering momentum. So that was actually the deciding factor in some cases.
Okay.
So the people handled it in a hybrid manner too. So they didn't actually take one route. So the first place solution, this guy seems to be looking for a postdoc right now. So the guy actually realized that this competition is actually similar to one he has done in the past. So and he realized it was similar to the click value rate prediction. So and he was able to identify that re-listening to the same song is like purchasing that song. And clicking, click through rate is actually the ratio of users who react to like an impression. So, or something you've added on the screen. So somebody who clicked, like how many users viewed your article, maybe, let's discuss this click value rate prediction. So somebody, you have an item. So how many people saw it and how many clicked on it? So if you're using click as a kind of a measure of impact, so you're trying to evaluate what impact that had on the people who had viewed it. So it's like, so this guy identified that stuff, and then he also made some assumptions about this not being suitable for latent factor method or neighborhood method. But the sixth place solution that I used latent factor approach and still got some pretty good results too. So, and then he identified that some items were missing because we have a sparse matrix. So, and he was able to figure out how it's missing. So I would actually, because handling missing cases in machine learning is a little bit tricky. So I devoted a slide for it. So you can actually get to see how you could handle it in the future if you come across it. So, but the point is, like, if you have some users and some music, and you're trying to see how long they listen to some music, there'll be some missing slots. Some users may not have listened to some music. So that would be empty. So it's not as if somebody decided not to put any data there or something. So it's by nature of the data itself that information is missing. So, and in that place, in that case, factorization methods will be useful if you can actually use the information from other kind of field you have to fill up that stuff. So actually, just to understand this solution, I would have to digress and take a branch from the normal flow of the execution of these slides to render those extra slides to make us understand more of what this guy was trying to do. So, and of course, he realized things were time sensitive. But after describing his stuff, he didn't present his solution actually. So that was the irony of it. So we're trying to infer what he has done. So it took a while to understand the motivations for his actions. So he realized that, okay, this way, like his results, and he had more than 30 assembled stuff. And then, so I would have to show you a view of how his pipeline looks. So I've been studying this for a while to see if I could fully understand what it meant. So, I don't know if, so it's like, okay, the first layer is actually the data processing he did. So he had, he was trying to derive some embeddings of cities. So his embeddings is actually you're trying to move to a dense representation of an entity where you have the distance has a meaning between two vectors. So it's like if you am I describing this right for people to understand? So it's like you're trying to represent. Usually we represent things like in a kind of one-hot encoding. That's like you have a data point, and you have different positions, and you say, okay, if this word occurs, then set that position to be one. So you now have a long list of a zero vector with just one in between. So that matches, like, you feel that match, that represent that entity. For instance, a location, maybe you're saying Vancouver is 001, Calgary is 010. So it's like you just have one bit to show, like, what your entity is. So now in embedding, so usually the length of that kind of a vector is the size of a vocabulary. Because that's the size of the entire word in your vocabulary. For in this case, in the cities, for instance, the vocabulary will be the total number of cities in his data set. Except he's using pre-trained network, which he did not specify. So in that case, you want to have a kind of a smaller representation that has a notion of distance between it. That, okay, if I have this vector, I can actually say, okay, if I look at the vector of Vancouver and Calgary, I can actually tell that it's closer to they're close to each other when compared to a place like South Korea. Maybe we can say Seoul, for instance, maybe having a kind of number different vector representation. So like this, there will be a longer distance from that one to Vancouver when compared to Calgary and Vancouver, because they are close by in the same continent. And the other one is in another continent. So that's just the idea behind embeddings. So this guy had a number of embeddings, one with the cities, one with the genders, one with the registration type, and then if he okay, he actually sent them into the neural network and did a lot of concatenation of some layers, the outputs he gets, he groups them together. So it's like, for instance, if this part of the model gives you one vector, like a three-length vector, like 001, and this one gives you 100, so you combine both of them and you get like 100001. So it's like you concat. So that was what he was doing. So he was just trying to capture all the possible relationships between different attributes in his data set. So he didn't give the code, and that was a major problem. So, and then, yeah, so he proceeded to explaining himself. Okay. So there were some concepts he was describing, and they were a bit tricky. So he was using a lot of embeddings, and he was also like this number five. I didn't understand that part when looking at that stuff. So I was looking for the code to see what that really meant. But I didn't see it, so I didn't understand what it meant by add a dot layer. So it's actually building a neural network, but having different kind of attributes with different embeddings fed into it. And because he had a number of models, some light GBM. Oh, I'm not explaining what light GBM is. So light GBM is just a tree-based model. So when you're trying to have it, a tree that you, okay, you classify your, if you have a data, you, it begins by choosing what, which is the most important, then you split based on that, and then until you get to the leaves. So just as a way to classify data, and then but probably there are many variants, so maybe some trees have to vote among themselves to choose which is better, or some trees may even have to if they misclassify, then they repeatedly train on that misclassified sample, so just like boosting. So that's what it is. So he used light GBM, and which he identified had, so with 400 features, and he didn't do so, and I was trying to think out what he meant. But he actually gave some idea for his conditional probability stuff. So he's actually conditioning on some attributes which he believes may have some relationship between them. So when they don't say things like condition of like you say source type condition on MSN type, it's, you can actually expand it out using Bayer's rule. So it's just actually like, in that case, it's just like counting when MS, okay, let's say this is number six, this part. So it's just like, if you use Bayer's rule, it's just like saying, in your data, when does this source type and this MSN number co-occur, for instance, they occur together, divided by the number of times when you have all MSN numbers. So it's just like, it's just, you try to find what's the impact of one attribute on the other. So that was what he was trying to do. So he was trying to find those interactions between different attributes. So because interaction plays a major role, so how one feature affects the other. So that was what he was doing in this. But he did them up to 400 features, so which is a bit tricky. But when we get to the third place solution, the guy had a clearer solution so than the first place solution. So I don't know if this can be implemented in production, because I don't know, I've not studied, I didn't see the code. So yeah, so then, yeah, usually he tried using SVT, and then some things he said that did not work. I actually read up what pseudo is and pseudo labeling. From what I read, it's more of you have a network, and then if you don't have enough data samples, you may go to your test data set and get data and train one of your models using your test data to predict it, and then add it to your training set, and then train everything afresh. So the benefit of this is it helps you I thought there was a blackboard here. I would have been writing things on the board, but so but the benefit of this is you end up regularizing. So it's like you're penalizing. You don't want your functions to learn the noise in the data. So you just want to penalize some weight. So that's what he said. He tried it and it didn't work. So and then he tried using things like a dropout with a tree-based method. That's that. So a dropout, I actually discussed it in my slides. So we'll get to that one when we get there. Yeah, and then he tried to use something that's an exponential moving average, like where it gives more weight to the current song. But I was trying to figure out how could he do it, since it's just a vector. What is he trying to do? And I couldn't figure out how one could have implemented that part from the description given. So then I'll proceed to the next slide. Oh, so full screen, yeah. So now, now when you want to check out missing data, there are many ways, that many kinds of missing data you can have in a data set. So one is missing completely at random. So what this means is like, you have a data set, and if you flip a coin, one is missing, one attribute is missing, you flip a coin, so it's like, there's no pattern to it, it's just totally random. So the probability of it occurring is, it's just like
noise.
Noise, too. So then, in that case, if you remove those samples that are occurring that way, you won't bias your data set. So it's the best case to remove it. Now, one problem is identifying when that's the case. That's the main constraint. So, yeah, so, but the point is if, from the papers I was reading, they said if the probability of missing is the same for all cases, so maybe the entropy is high in that context. So then that attribute can be freely removed from the data set and you can proceed. So don't even bother doing imputation. You won't have any benefits from doing that. Then it's a missing at random. So this depends on for instance, missing at random is like, there's a bit of a mix, like the paper was written by Andrew Gelman, this guy. So it's a bit similar to based on one of the variables to some extent. So it's like, if you're gathering data sets about like a medical experiment going on, if people in that experiment, in that medical clinical trial, have any bad side effects, or they don't like what happened to them in that experiment, they can stop halfway, and then you may not have the data. So from what he explained, or somebody maybe died before some data was captured. So it's not as if they don't want to provide the data, but it's like something has happened. So, yeah. So just like, and again, the missing, depending on missing value itself. So for instance, if you have a kind of a survey and you're asking people for how much they are paid, and some people, because of some social factors and maybe some other data they've given, they may not want to fill up that part. So but in those kind of contexts, you can actually use the data they provided to infer what is missing. But you should be careful not to introduce bias in your data. So there are many ways of handling it. So and that's just like excluding the data, imputation, list value, carry it forward.
The last one is actually kind of interesting. I've seen some kind of crazy stuff where people, they train a model specifically to predict the missing values. So it becomes a whole different training step. And then they use that to fill in the missing values.
Yeah, I was reading through a lot of canyons, and people are actually complaining that whenever they build a model that way, complex model to predict, the results sometimes are not so great from just very simple methods like mean imputations.
Yeah, I think the fancy methods don't help, but they're clever.
Yeah, they're clever too. So the third place solution, he was able to, he was saying generate features from the future. So this is just using a lot of things. What he actually meant is like, from the current position where you are in your data, go forward a bit, go into the future and get some data there, and then get some past as your like a window from the past too, and then use both of them to get your data. So I actually exploited this in my solution, but in my own solution, in that context, I used bidirectional LSTM. So that's what it does, because you want to use, so because somebody listens, okay, imagine somebody listening to a song right now. The song they listened in the past will have a bearing on what he listens in the future. So if you're actually capturing the future and taking some of your past when building your model, you do well, actually, because there's a lot of information in the future. So that's what this guy did, and his code is very clear. So then he actually added some extra attributes. So like taking some memes, you see what all those things, they sound fancy when you describe it. So these are not mine. So when I was writing it, I just copied what he had written on the slides. So this is not plagiarism. So yeah, then he actually tried out something that I have not seen before also. Like he tried out this regression in each of the data points, he added an extra field for time. He actually introduced time by force. So, but his time is actually using a kind of a count, and then he used it to form a regression model with some of the features and on the labels he's trying to predict. It's a kind of a linear, those kind of least square estimates, those kind of least square estimates kind of formulation. So it was very straightforward, and I was actually thinking, how did he was able to think this out? It's like this was very clever when I saw it, and I loved it. So then he was also considering the difference between the last time you heard the song and when the song was played again. So that has some information too. So and he also had considered the time for the next song to be played. So from the current time that you are in. And you also consider the which songs are unique too. You know, there's also one thing in recommender systems, because in recommender systems too, sometimes actually predicting something that there's this surprise or surprise too. So people are also fascinated when they are surprised by a song too. So there's how some models are trying to pull it in place. So this guy actually trying to capture that feature. It is part of the open problem in recommender systems. How to put in some amount of surprise too. There's also somebody listening to only rock every day. Maybe excited when he suddenly hears a rap song. He goes, oh, this looks cool in his ears. So how to feed in that part. So that's what he was trying to do with the unique part. And his data was very clear to understand. So and then he used the matrix factorization. So that's why I will also give a mini tutorial on matrix factorization.
20 minutes,
okay. So I'll go around. So let me go back to this guy's code. And then, so he just loaded up the data and then performed the normal joins on them. So these joints are just to connect one table to the next. And yeah, so you can have a full table. And then did some kind of what one of the code, this label encoder stuff. It's similar to one of the code. So this was where he added his own time. So he used the index. He used the index of this data and then added his time. So, and then it's also using this HDF, so it's like, so even, so it doesn't...
So you use the index as a, he interprets each row as a new time step.
Yes.
Okay.
So, and then he considered using some kind of to minimize data use of memory. Because in this competition, I had a lot of memory issues. So like you run out of memories. So I think that's why it's using those drive system HDF stuff. So this is actually the code where this is this part is where he was actually splitting things out into the future and into the history, into the past. So, and it was really very nice in the way he arranged things. So then he grouped things. Yeah, he had some grouping and took some means of some attributes and then some counts. So this is the regression part I was speaking about. So I won't go into everything, just the highlights to cover up the main part. So then, yeah, this was this is just normal a linear regression least square estimation. Yeah, then time, so this was how he was calculating the time from the past and time. So, and he actually did very well in the competition. So, I think this one was very nice. So, and this was the final assembly when he was combining his data. He figured out that the 0.6 and 0.4. But the problem I think he did not add this code for cross-validation. So, which was part of the issue I was having. So, I don't know, maybe that was the secret sauce. So, because he wouldn't have known it's 0.6 just by random. He would have done some experiment to figure that out. So, oh, okay.
So one question, what are these things that he puts together?
What?
The linear combination of the different things, what are
the predictions. He had multiple.
So it's an ensemble between.
Ensembles. And then that was the last phase. More like the voting, but this is a regression at that last phase. So this is just multi-factorization, so this is just a fancy name for just getting the matrix that kind of rating matrix, for instance. So just a matrix that you want to get the weight at which a vector links to a label, actually. So you're trying to use some existing data that have been filled up. So if you fill up the other ones, by the time you optimize on that function, the remaining value will be. So there are multiple methods here. I don't know if we can go through this, but there's. I think let's leave that for now. Okay, I think we can discuss that over drinks and lunch. So, yeah, then the six-place solution, it does have SVD. So, this is just what SVD is. SVD is just like you have a matrix, so you want to split it apart. So, you want to have a kind of lower dimensional representation of this data that captures as much information as possible. So now, for instance, this U matrix, it's like you have it a smaller representation of your data, which sometimes less noisy and more dense than the sparse matrix that you began with. So, and that's usually very informative. So that's what he tried to do on the user versus sum matrix, interaction matrix. And he tried to do that also. Because he actually had a factorization, he ran that factorization method that I didn't have time to explain based on how we were proceeding with this. And then he did one thing here that I didn't do. I think he did this embedding of artists, lyricists. So he created an embedding of those. And yeah, and those are very informative. And then he used LightGMB, fed it into LightGMB. And he didn't explain his, he didn't release his code yet. So, but from what he has described, you can actually figure out what he actually did just from the plain description. So I'll go to my solution. So my solution is actually based on, I actually use a bidirectional LSTM. So it's like having two LSTMs where you train by feeding your data point in one direction and then reversing your data input and feeding it back into the other direction, into the same direction. So in that case, you are capturing both the future and the past. So, and then because why actually is an LSTM is like, because you see this data set, there's a relationship between each timestamp. There's the relationship between each music. There's a relationship too. And there's a kind of a global information between one user and other users that are similar. So, and because at that point, most of my attempts were failing. So I decided to say neural network should be able to capture some of those latent relationships among the user. So maybe I can be getting a lot of things in one, like getting the kind of relational collaborative kind of filter and some forms of content-based filter in one model. So then there's I actually saw a good way of, so this was an LSTM, so this solves the vanishing gradient problem and this like. So don't get carried away by gates. Gates are just functions that return 0 or 1. So, but this is what they mean conceptually. So, and this is just like, they said that you're dealing with the block. So you're trying to use information from the previous block to the next block. So, yeah, so just like, you wanna get a representation that captures temporal dependence across your data into the future. From the past. So it's like, that's what an LSTM does. You actually try to get temporal dependencies. So and there's actually a temporal dependency in our data. If you look at how one song leads to the next, there's actually a dependency. And since we don't have this time to split things apart, you want to learn, you just want a model that can learn those latent as a kind of a latent variable. So, and I think LSTMs could do well if you have more time to speak to. Now this is just some description about LSTMs. So, yeah, but at first when I began, I was trying to use a kind of a many-to-many model. Like, okay, let me take some boundaries from the past and then feed it and some to the future. But then I ran into a problem of boundary detection. So how many of the history should I keep? And how many of the future should I have? And so I decided to change my approach. So, and then it was like 3 days to go. So I had to change my approach and try to just use the data set that has been joined across all the relevant features. It will filter out the rest itself. And then if I can, if I optimize, if I'm very conservative in the way I build this network, by using things like regularizing in all forms, by be it batch normalization. So I don't want to, what's batch normalization? I would actually get there soon. So I have to build a network that has the ability to also regularize itself, and also I don't want to normalize my data itself. I want the infrastructure itself of the code to normalize the data for me. So and this actually does that. So and it actually improves your speed. And yeah, it's like you want to have a balanced distribution between your test and your training data set. So that's what this is what batching, and it actually does a lot of regularization underneath. So there's a lot of benefit to regularizing your data because, for instance, if you have a lot of, if you have a kind of a complex model to build, and you don't have a lot of, you don't want to overfit, because I just have 3 days to go, there's no time to debug. So you have to be very conservative in how you build a model, so you don't take chances with overfitting in any form. So, and that's why I was using models that were like, very conservative in preventing overfitting. And then I also tried out dropouts in each of my layers. So what the dropout is just what's shown in the picture. So it's just like you have some relationship between your models, and you just want to, with the probability, you switch off some of the connections. And then, so it's like, the point, as they said in Hinton's book, you want to stop the interaction, because sometimes the model you're learning may not actually be the distribution of your that features with the of the test set, because you may be learning noise. So, but if you do this kind of flipping, and you may actually reduce the amount of noise you get, and then this actually improves data. So, because the set is much better than actually kind of a model averaging of multiple models. So now, for instance, if you actually in my situation where you're running out of time, and the competition ends, only 5 submissions per day. So you have to be very conservative because you can't submit twice or 2 times. So I had like 3 days to go, and I only had like 7 submissions that I can make. So every submission must count, otherwise you screwed. So that was part of the design. Then I tried to do some kind of cross validation. I was just thinking, okay, since there's a relationship between the future and the past, why can't I just have some kind of a training data set and watch one block in the future, and then just do that with cross validates, and then take an average, So I didn't see that in the textbook, so I don't know how right it may be. But it was a bit close to what I was seeing in the leaderboard in some respect. But it was taking so much time. So just doing a hyperparameter search may take you almost the whole day, which is not actually it is not what you do when you have limited time on your hands. So yeah, but actually this is actually the one of the codes that resulted from this. So I just there's actually a way of calculating AUC using Keras and neural networks. So I saw that blog post in Cargo. So AUC is actually non-differentiable. But there's a clever way some people actually ended up approximating the AUC. And when you check it with the real AUC, the difference is like correct to like three decimal places. So it's pretty much AUC. So because of the in those kind of situations in the competition, you wanna just use the right, you don't wanna tie any form of Prosy loss function, because you can't actually use a non-differentiable function. So I had to figure out there's an AUC way of doing doing this stuff. So because all the traditional machine learning model I tried were failing me. So at that point it was like just get something to work and so on, and that was what I actually did. So but this was not the starting block. So I think if somebody actually modifies a neural network properly, with one model you can actually get better results too, because the data set is large. And if you're very conservative in how you build your network, preventing overfitting in every form, you should be able to get some improved results too. And just from one network alone. So rather than having 100 models and trying things out. So yeah, and so
you've got 10 minutes, so
okay.
No worries. I do have a question. Do you have some intuition on why you used looks like four layers of bidirectional STM?
Yeah, there's a relationship between the number of parameters and your data set. So if you have a lot of data, you can actually increase the length. So this can actually be bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So but actually just a lot of times it becomes a bit.
You're just trying to make the model more complex, essentially, adding more parameters. That was your thinking.
I was just trying to learn it, just in more than I could learn, because of course I was getting noise also.
Mm.
So I then tried adding like the bidirectional stuff improved stuff and it changed to learning some stuff from the AUC scores that were coming up. And then the batch normalization also helped too. And it improved a bit. So and then there's this, where is this? That one decomplex also. So if because of the data set more than 3 million, I could actually increase this length as much as I wanted. But I have the constraint of time too, so yeah. Okay.
I see you use wiki only once.
Yeah.
Not otherwise. Is there a particular reason why that was the spot?
I was just trying to use a function at least that lets out that does not shut everything down completely, lets them go. So it's just a design decision. So and I saw some papers where people were saying, okay, it helps to make things faster. So and then on the last 2-3 days, I just had to try what I believe is tested and trusted. So you want to go
through? Yeah, how long did it take?
It took me 12 hours. It took me 12 hours.
On your laptop or on
I have a GTX 1080 system. So I only set it up and sleep. So then by morning, it's the day results. So the machine should work for us, you know.
It also gets you out of bed in the morning, right?
Yeah, I woke up in the morning to check it out. So. Yeah, so then we are done with the phrase and other stuff. So actually, after doing some research, I realized HMM method could work with this. Because you could actually have because you have a state and measurement. Because I've been doing a lot of research on state-based methods and Kármán filters for a while. And I realized there is actually a relationship I could use. If you say your states are actually the labels, and then you see your measurement actually vectors representing the songs. You can actually use a Getty algorithm on this. That can give you a very good prediction of the speeds. But will that capture all the relationship with internally, and how is that different from an LSTM? Because you're still capturing some kind of those Markovian based dependency between stuff. But anyway, that could work for someone new research. And there's a method I would like to introduce to you all. There's this mass method. I think people are not using it well enough in this group. A lot of people are not using it. You should try it out. It works. So it's like what's it called? Multiple adaptive splines, regression splines. So it's just like you want to fit a regression, and you split your problem space into multiple subsets. And then try to fix the thing and disjoint it. So, and the way this model works is like a two-pass algorithm, and it does a lot of feature combinations for you and helps you get some of the best model. That's almost like cost and benefit. So it works very well in other sectors, not so much common in cargo compositions. So another one I should let you know about is Amphis. So Amphis is actually a kind of neural infrastructure. It's used for like periodic time series. But I couldn't use it in this competition because of I was having memory issues with the part where I get the loss function, the mean spread loss. So it always breaks there. And I didn't figure out if fix it in cargo because it's a lot better at that point. It just breaks on that point. So but it's actually a combination of the Fuzzy logic and the neural network. So you're getting the ability to learn from a neural network and ability to make inference logic constructs that you have from logic calculus. So it gives you both, and it works well for multiple times. So yeah, logic regression and APRs. So those are always standard methods. So then what I figured out is like going for a kind of competition, there's a trade-offs you have to experience. So you should actually spend your time building model or building infrastructure. But if it's your first competition like mine, this was my first competition. You might only spend some time also building infrastructure, not only building models. It was that you could use in your next competition. So then why build infrastructure? You may not actually be building models, and that's actually, when others are actually making solutions, you're actually building infrastructures, and that makes you slow down. So and then building a failing model versus trying out a new model. So that's also a challenge. When do you know you have to stop using a model? That's very difficult. You don't know because you may think, oh, I need to talk through two, three parameters and it should work. And that's something you should also have to figure out. Because at some point, your models are not meant for some problems. So you should actually figure out the sweet spots to switch to a different model if something doesn't work. And then, for this competition, feature engineering actually tends to give better results than sometimes better algorithms in some cases. So this is more in general basis. So, yeah, I realize also the depth of your neural network related to how the number of training samples you have, you can fix things. But if you regularize properly, you can actually fix a complex network with minimal data. So there's a lot of theory, there's some theory around the presentation and discusses this kind of stuff. So, and then I found that the hard way that assembling doesn't always work when the conditions are right. So when you assemble models, you get better results when you have diverse models. So if you have models that are like so similar in nature, things may not actually work. And you can also get a different model by actually changing the loss functions. You can have the same model and try out multiple loss functions, and that's different models too. So yeah, and there's a place of magic numbers too in cargo competitions. So I was actually trying to figure out how do these people look at magic numbers, how do they figure it out? And then I realized that they sometimes look at the initialized data set and see that there's a kind of offset between the test and the training distribution, and then add the offset or the scalar value. So because I was thinking, how do these data add plus 4 and then things work out? I was looking through some channels and just add some numbers. And I was trying to figure out how do they do this, because this cannot be rocket science. So and then I feel like, oh, they actually sometimes take average of the training set and the data set and see some offset and try to use it together. And then in this and in some other competitions too, I later realized that leakages may actually be a good thing. It may not actually be a bad thing the way people say. Because sometimes, if for instance in this competition, if somebody for instance maybe there's a metadata that added the timestamp, and then somebody used this to augment this model and did a very good job. That may actually give the sponsors of this competition the insight that, for instance, time is actually a good attribute. So this can actually be a way for them to uncover attributes that are very predictive too, that they may not have considered. But one thing I figured out why they didn't put it is like they want to have a model that will work into the future over time, so that it's not tied to time. So and that makes sense. So they want to gain everything in one competition. They don't want to do another competition again next year. So they want to use 5,000 bots and get it all at once. So, and yeah, thanks for listening.